Hotep community, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show. We're going to have, hopefully we're going to have Dr. Edwin Nichols here with us today. He's having a little bit of a technical difficulties getting in. We're going to take a pause for the cause. I just wanted to come online and wish all of you, thank you so much for tuning in. Hope you are safe and well wherever you are in the world. And so we will have an epic conversation with Dr. Nichols if we can get all of his technology working correctly. And I will put this on pause, so I will be back. Hotep, I see you, Greg, out there. I see Mavis Beckman. I see you out there, Hotep community. I'll be right back. Hold on, family. Hey, family, still waiting on Dr. Nichols. He's working on it, and hopefully we'll have this rectified soon so we can have this on. If not, yeah, we're going to have to probably postpone or reschedule, but this is technology, and this is what we have to do in this day and age. So I appreciate your patience. Be right back, family. Thank you so much, community. I see Rolando out there. Thank you for letting us take all the time we need. We got to do what we got to do. Fundu, I see you out there. Chauncey, thank you. Coyote Prophet, my brother from another mother, looking forward to working with you. I see Kim Grant is out there. Janine is with us. Ados is with us. Hilda is with us. And I'm also getting work done on the ceiling and roof. So you might hear some other stuff going on in the background. It's a crazy Monday, family. I'm just letting you know. CC, I see you out there. Underdog, what's going on, my brother? Maxine Grant from the UK. Brian Bino, my brother from another mother. Y'all are just absolutely awesome. Thank you so much. Please be patient with me and hold on. So we try to get Dr. Nichols up to snuff on this StreamYard, in these StreamYard streets out here. See you in a moment, fam. Still working on it, family, still getting it together. Just wanted to come back and let you know so that y'all ain't watching a scrolling ticker for all these minutes. I see all of y'all are loading it and loading up. My goodness, there's so many of you out there. Thank you so much. Sandra, I see you out there. Sandra Hinton, caseworker, I see you out there. Six-figure days, love that. Six-figure days versus six-figure years. I like that even better. Brooklyn Queen, I see you out there. Madame Magna, I see you. Pamela Green. Uh-oh, I think we see Dr. Nichols. Wait a minute, what's going on there? I see something coming on, Dr. Nichols.
All right, okay.
Now I just got to see you.
Yeah, well.
You got to turn your camera around because I see some markers there.
Yeah, well, that's...
Hold on, let me hang up so I can not get a background feed because we can hear you. Can you hear me now? So we
go ahead.
We might just have his hand in, tonight. We just might have those three markers.
Let me see where the. How can I do this now? Let me see. Okay, wait.
I knew Dr. Nichols was going to figure it out. This brother's a genius. So if anybody can figure it out, it's Dr.
Nichols. What I can do here, let me see. Oh, that's the live stream.
Maxine says, we have time. We are under house arrest here in the UK. KK. Yeah, well, you know what's going on in these United States streets right now. It's absolutely insane. That's why we wanted to have conversation with Dr. Nichols to say, what's going on? How is dichotomous logic and the philosophical aspects of cultural difference can apply to what we have just experienced and what we are in the middle of experiencing? Because in, what is it, in 2 days, we have the inauguration. So thank you for that, Maxine. Thank you for that six-figure days. This is going to be epic once we get his camera, I guess, turned around so we can see him. Otherwise, he just unplugged something. I don't know. Can you still hear me, Doc?
I can hear you, but I'm not getting me on the picture. That's the problem.
we might just have to take that, but we'll, you know, put the plug back in and turn the camera around and whatever. We'll look at those four markers and say, that's Dr. Nichols right there. You know, we'll work through it.
Let's see. Something else here.
And we've got some handouts that I can also do with the screen share as you narrate. So that's another plus that we're going to be able to give to the family as we go through this work and this conversation. And it's, oh my goodness, there's a lot of you out there. I know y'all love some Dr. Nichols just like I do. So I know y'all love some Dr. Nichols. Look at that now. Look at that now. Fantastic. Is your mic on?
Yeah, it's on.
Okay, fantastic. Well, welcome, Dr. Nichols. Looking all regal and like you just came from a kung fu class, like you're just a grand, looking like a grandmaster. I just love you to pieces.
Listen,
okay, family, welcome to the Food Matthew Show.
I'm trying to perspire, so let me put on a show.
Take your time. Do what you got to do. So we've been, you know, as you know, I'm a madman out here in these internet streets trying to give the best and latest scientific understanding, psychological understanding of what's happening to us, because ain't nothing wrong with us. So had a great conversation with Dr. Nichols about last week sometime, and trying to get a date set for when he could be able to come on. And I just thought that there's probably no better person like to come back after we had that conversation with Professor Kaba to come back and kind of put this situation in such a scholarly context and framework as Dr. Nichols. And so I'm really excited about the conversation that we're going to have today. What is that, Rolando? You're humbled. If you're humbled, imagine how I feel to be here with Dr. Nichols. This is absolutely amazing. Love this brother. One of our greatest scholars and elders. Okay, so Dr. Nichols, I also have, do you want me to try to share my screen with those Word documents that you sent to me? Or do you want to have a conversation a little bit first and then go into it?
Well, what we can do is let's kind of start a conversation, then we can go to that document and talk about it. Okay.
Fantastic.
So, the initial things that I'm here in the encampment of Washington, D.C. We have had an experience with marauders that came and tried to take over the city, took over the Capitol building, and boldly walked in and took their place and did what they wanted to do, and then very boldly walked away. My only question is, had that been a group of people from the Black Lives Matter, would their experience have been the same?
Absolutely not, but yes.
So, you know, I think we need to understand that what is defined as violence is Black. What is defined as patriotic and nonviolent is White.
Mm.
So when we are nonviolent, they are violent. So matter, Black Lives Matter was not a violent thing. Okay, now you have always sociopaths or hustlers who, it's, you know, they break up shops and steal and all that kind of stuff. But that has nothing to do with the main group of people who are working to better their condition. To better their condition.
Mm-hmm.
So when they are nonviolent, Black Lives Matter, protesting, then the police are violent.
Mm.
See how that works?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when the white protesters are violent, the police are nonviolent. Look at the Capitol. How many times have you seen major police forces as they came in? Why didn't anybody shoot? There was only one person shot. All the guns they had, if they really wanted to keep all those people out, they could have fired guns at one volley or two volleys, or then people would have turned around and thought about it again. But they permitted them throughout the whole building, all the destruction and everything that they did. Police were standing there looking at them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay? Mm-hmm. So you have to ask yourself, why is that?
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that that is that the white population, this is the right thing, okay? But it also sort of creeps in toward the middle.
Mm-hmm.
It's the center right and the right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This group of people, what is motivating their behavior is the fear that they will no longer be able to govern the country as a white country by white people. On one of the casts, one of the newscastings, you could hear in Georgia, a guy make a comment, and he was trying to get people to think what it meant to vote for the two candidates who came out of Georgia. And he said, do you want a nigger and a Jew to represent you?
Wow. He literally said that. Okay.
What is the existentialistic reality of that now in Georgia?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You have a Black and you have a Jew representing. And you see, when you go all the way back to the Reformation, to the Reconstruction period,
mm-hmm.
at the beginning, Blacks had the vote. They had seats in the Senate and one seat in the Senate and several in the Congress and so forth, and certainly in the local legislation.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then you had an organization called the Red Shirts in Mississippi. They had a uniform with a red coat, and they went around terrorizing Blacks and preventing them from voting.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of caught on across the rest of the southern states and other states. Now, they don't all wear the red coats, but the behavior was the same. The Klan took that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, when you compare that to Germany, the brown shirts in Germany and the black shirts in Italy were the same group of vandals that ran around beating up people and doing things. But you see what you're hearing something about it now is that Hitler killed the brown shirts after they had done for him. He killed them. Now, after all this that they did by occupying the seat of our government, what was Trump's speech, the one he read? I don't take any violence. I don't have anything to do with that. That those people do not represent me. You put them under the bus. So what happened to the brown church, in essence, happened to the white supremacists. You get them under the bus. Now, what that does is a disillusionment for that group, and they will find someone else to lead them that they can trust.
So do they, so based upon that, do you feel that they feel now that Trump has betrayed them? Or do they look at that canned speech as a sign of him having to do what he had to do so he would try to get his least legal
culpability? It as the betrayal of Trump, because we did what you said to do and you put us under the bus. So you have that group kind of split in terms of how they, some will say, well, you know, he had to say that. The others would say, well, he didn't have to say it because we did what he said do. So why would he tell us to do something and then tell us it was wrong?
A lot of cognitive dissonance, absolutely. So this is really interesting and fascinating how you frame this, and it fits perfectly with dichotomous logic. Could you, for those who have not watched the previous time that you were on, and I'm so sorry, it's been a year since you've been back with us, but can you go into dichotomous logic? And also, after that, can you speak to us about the cycle, the philosophical aspects of cultural differences, and you know, the person, the African being person to person, the European being person to the object, the Asian being person to the group, and how does that manifest and connect with what we just saw on the 6th of January, but now what we're also seeing in protests around the country.
Okay, if you can pull up your dichotomous logic slide.
All right, let me see if I can do this screen share, family. Let's see what we get here.
You do it yourself. You do it. You have it.
Okay, now I have to, it's not allowing me to go to, okay, so I have to do it a different way. Hold on a second, Doc. I've got to upload it to my Chrome here. Hold on a second. Hold on, family. This is what it's looking like here today. We're getting it together, though. These were Word documents. Where are the Word documents? Come on, now. We're going to find you. That's text. Okay. Those are the Word documents. And we're downloads. One paragraph. Okay, we've got that. So we're going to open that, put that up. And we've got to look for, what's the name of the document? And one is
one is psychotomous logic, the other is the philosophical aspects of cultural difference, the paradigm. Okay. Find it. Looks like a chart. One looks like a chart. It's, you know, that's the philosophical aspects of cultural difference. Dichotomous logic is primarily two columns.
Okay, I've just got to find it here. I know it's here because I opened it in Word document. I just got to find it in the, let's see here. Hold on, fam. I know y'all talking about me bad. Y'all don't normally see me like this, do you? You're just like, whoa, look at Philippe. He normally has all this stuff together. Okay, there we go. There it is. All right, so now I need to open them up. Once it uploads into Google Drive, there it is. That's one open, and that would be two open. And now we're going to go back. I'm going to share my screen here. And let's see if you can see this. Doc, are you able to see this?
Now that's the chart.
Okay. Yeah. Now this is the dichotomous logic. Yes.
That's it.
Okay. Okay. You want me to make it a little larger?
I can see it. You have to make it larger so the other people can see it.
Okay. Let's see if it's going to be pretty big there. Okay. There we go.
Then you can rotate it. All right. Let's start off with it. It is now. There's nothing wrong with dichotomous logic. Dichotomous logic is either or. Okay. So it's plus or minus, yes or no, A or B, zero or one. It's binary. And by itself, there's nothing wrong with it. But when you misuse dichotomous logic, it forms isms, and isms give privilege. Now, people are always talking about privilege, privilege, privilege. Well, let's see what privilege is. Privilege is a special advantage, immunity, permission, right, or benefit granted to or enjoyed by individual, class, or caste. See that word, caste? Now, there's a book out, Caste, that a sister wrote, and you better get it and read it if you haven't read it already. Okay? Such a right or advantage held as a prerogative of status or rank. Now, this is the most important part about it, because when you talk about white privilege, what it does, it is it's an exercise to the exclusion or detriment of others. So white privilege says that if there's something to be had, I can have it to your exclusion, or I can have it even to your detriment, because it is my privilege. So how many times have we experienced things that are to our detriment? Okay, like redlining. And it is because we didn't have white privilege. All right, now there are three steps necessary to form an ism. One, use cultural bias to determine which characteristics are good and which characteristics are bad. Two, state who is good and who is bad. Then three, socialize everyone to believe the ism to be truth and to act upon that truth. We now call it alternative facts.
You see?
It's not the truth. It's that truth. See the wording?
Got it.
All right. One. You see a list of assertive, aggressive, and you see submissive, passive. Okay. Two columns. So to be assertive, I'm saying to you, is good, and to be submissive is bad. But this statement is my Western cultural bias. Cultural bias? Why? Because in some world cultures, to be submissive is to be good. So you see, it's my Western cultural bias. To be aggressive is good, and to be submissive is bad. Now, the second step is to state who is good and who is bad. And just by doing that alone, you form the ism, and it gives privilege.
Gotcha.
Then the next thing is you are to socialization imprints the ism. Concept of socialization, concept, principles, and ideas repeated so much that it becomes the norm. Okay, that's socialization. And conveys the status of truth to the ism. So the socialization is the constant tweeting by Trump and by Fox and by those networks. And they repeat it so much that it becomes truth and gives them the ism. So let's look at these first groups. Assertive, aggressive, power. So assertive, and the opposite of it is to be submissive. Aggressive, passive, strong, powerless. I'm so powerful, powerless, strong, weak, fearless, fearful, intelligent, ignorant, independent, dependent. Now, if you were to write, if you were to write above the column that says aggressive, and you wrote the word good, and on the column that says submissive, you wrote bad, I'm now telling you that the characteristics of good are assertive, aggressive, powerful, strong, fearless, intelligent, independent.
Mm-hmm.
The characteristics of bad, submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, dependent. Now, I want on the good side to add male, on the bad side, female. So immediately I have formed what ism.
Should I type this in?
Well, you can if you want.
So this one is supposed to be good.
And the other one is bad.
And this one over here is now, wait a minute, see. How does that work there? Okay, we'll do it back there. All right, bad.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and
male.
Male.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And female.
And female.
All right, now let's stop for a moment and see what you have. You have males are good because we are assertive, aggressive, powerful, strong, fearless, intelligent, and independent. Women are bad. Well, they are submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, and dependent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We've done the two and we formed the isms, we formed sexism.
Mm-hmm. Now,
the thing up there at the top is socialization imprints the ism. So I have to socialize young girls to believe that this that I told you about is truth.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So I start very early with little girls and I say, oh, don't try to do that. You're not what? Strong enough.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then I tell you, get whom to help you? Your brother or male?
Mm-hmm.
I'm imprinting sexism. Okay?
This is great.
Now I say to you, we want you to be, you're not very strong.
Mm-hmm.
I want to instill something else in you. Don't go in the dark room. Something will get you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fearful. And boys, of course, are fearless in our socialization of them.
That's right.
All right, now let's see what happens. It is now the ninth grade. Don't take algebra because algebra is too hard.
Mm-hmm.
Which really means you're too dumb to learn it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Girls can learn it, but ignorant girls cannot. Now, the reality of that is an American byproduct. Because if you go to high school graduations throughout the world, like the baccalaureate in the French system, or the abitur in the German system, or the matur in the Austrian and South American systems,
mm-hmm.
everyone graduating has had calculus.
Mm-hmm.
All the way through calculus. And they don't tell girls you don't have to take it because you have a math phobia. You see how we've made it pathological?
Absolutely.
Math is because you have a math phobia.
Wow.
It's pathological. That's why you can't do it. Now, after that, we have successfully told you that you're too weak to do it, you're too dumb to do it, and you're powerless.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you look at that, then the next step is girls will say to you, well, I don't believe that. Well, that could end it, but we have to give the socialization. Well, Dr. Nichols, why is this happening? My child, it is God's will.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He made men and he made women. And he made men strong and big and healthy, and they are to protect and take care of the humble little woman. It's God's will. Now, how hard is that to fight that?
Absolutely. I hope the family is also recognizing the fact that this is how all, particularly Christianity, but all religions, many religions are based on this male good figure, meaning the female is bad. I mean, the entire false story of Adam and Eve, she's biting off the apple, she's bad. Eve is good. And so this is the narrative. And then when they put that God on it, if you believe in the white boy in the sky or the white boy in the stick or the white boy on the boat that brought all this crap to us, this is what we're facing and dealing with. But intergenerationally, we've been dealing with this since they stole us from our land 500 plus years now.
Okay, now something else is very interesting about the Adam and Eve story.
Mm-hmm.
When you go into East Africa, you ask the same question. When God says, who told you to eat the apple? And Adam says, the woman you gave me. So whose fault is it? You gave me this woman. In East Africa, they say, we ate the apple. Is that relationship, you know?
Person to person, people to people.
There we are.
Wow. Wow. Thank you for that, Dr. Nichols. That was powerful.
Okay.
That was great insight. Wow. That's enlightening. That's enlightening. So I am because we are, or you are because I am.
Yes. Now we go further, because there's some women say, look, I don't believe in that crap. That's mm-hmm. I don't believe it. Well, then what you have to do is you cannot let that behavior continue. So you say that that behavior, when you act like that, you are a what? A woman who acts that way is a what?
Well, I don't want to use the word, but.
Okay, well, this begins with B.
It begins with B, yes, sir.
And they say, well, I've been called that many times, it doesn't bother me. Now you have to go to making her behavior pathological.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that women are acting this way is because Professor Dr. Sigmund Freud himself has told us that women suffer from penis envy.
Wow.
She's now mentally ill.
Wow.
Excuse me.
Sure, Doc.
Okay, I just had to cut that off because it's...
No problem.
All right, there we go.
So in order to control and social and continue that socialization, now we've had to make her mentally ill.
That's right.
Wow.
I mean, it's quite clear. She's neurotic. She needs
right.
treatment. Because
sure.
she's suffering from penis envy.
Wow. Insane in the membrane.
It's a problem. We have therapy to suffer. A few years in psychotherapy, she'll be fine.
Mm-hmm.
So not only she is now a crazy what B word.
Yep. Yep. I see that. That's incredible how you've put this together and how you've mapped this out.
Okay, now let's go down to the next set.
Okay.
All right. On the good side, it says wealth, industrious, thrift. Well, let's go wealth, poverty, industrious, lazy, thrifty, wasteful, prompt, tardy, clean, dirty, beautiful, ugly, valuable, valueless. You see what I'm doing there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we now have the dichotomy. Now, if you go back up to the top, where you were writing in the names, the words, and now I want you to write on the good side, white.
You want me to put it here, or want me to put it on the wealth?
Wherever you put it,
it works wherever it goes.
Yeah.
White.
Mm-hmm. And then on the other side, under female, black.
Hold on a second. I think I messed up. Wait a minute. Hold on here, facts. Folks, Rev Shock will get this together here. Wait a minute. That goes there. So we're going to go down from this side. There we go. And then we're going to put white there. And subsequently,
black.
That goes here. There we go. All right. Got it.
All right. Now, white males are assertive, progressive, powerful, strong, fearless, intelligent, and dependent. They aspire to wealth because they're industrious and thrifty and prompt. They live in clean, beautiful, valuable suburban housing paid for with oil depletion allowances, farm subsidies, and tech shelter.
Wow.
Wives dutifully bring them a cocktail in the evening or a can of beer contingent upon their socioeconomic class. Chastity and virtuousness are essential for legitimacy in passing on property.
Mm-hmm.
Black women are submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, dependent. Why do they live in poverty? They're lazy, they're wasteful, they're never on time, and they have a lot of dirty, ugly, worthless children because they're hedonistic, promiscuous. These illegitimate children are worthless to our society because they drain our resources in welfare. Those women cheat on food stamps, and they have extra babies just to get IDC.
I hope the family is seeing how, I mean, when we talk about dichotomous logic, when, you know, as you have taught me so many times, and I've repeated it again and again, how you reason to an answer is logic. When you see it here, literally in black and white and with yellow highlights, it's scary. It's painful. It's like, there it is. And now we're in the inside, the mind of this Amu, of this second frequency European. How they see you, no matter how well you treat them, no matter how much you smile, no matter how many jokes you crack, no matter how well you sing, doesn't matter. This is the op, and it's unconscious to them. It's not even something that they're necessarily thinking about. Is that right, Doc?
Yeah, it can be, because it's implicit. Now, look, let's go to Clinton, President Clinton.
Okay.
He believed this whole column about black women, and you had what act did he pass? The Welfare Reform Act. It throws black women up off their behinds and make them go to work. And give them whatever is necessary so not have so many babies.
Incredible. There it is. So, that being said, Doc, can I unshare my screen and we have a little talk and then come back?
Of course. All right. Yeah.
Let me come back to our time here. Okay, great. So, and looking at this understanding of dichotomous logic, can you once again give us the framework of how that connects to the mentality that we just saw on the 6th? Because what I loved about it at the beginning, you talked about how it would be treated differently if it was Black Lives Matter versus if it was what we just saw at the state capitol. Put that dichotomous logic into that context.
Okay. Well, either or, right? So if it is a group of Black Lives Matter, they are nonviolent in their in what they do, the parades and so on. I'm not talking about the pathology that comes from the hustlers. I'm talking about the people in the actual march. So it's a nonviolent movement. So if one is nonviolent, then the other has to be what? If black is nonviolent, what does white have to be? Okay, what did you see when Martin Luther King was nonviolent?
Extreme violence
on the white population.
Right.
That's the dichotomy.
Wow.
So now what happened at the Capitol?
See, this is a whole nother level of framework. I'm so loving this. This dichotomous logic. I'm so loving this. And I'm so thankful for you to bring this to the community because this, you know, we got all the others, so we know about the Ice Age, we got the psychological, we've got all of that, you know, Francis Cress Wilson work and birth, dearth, and all of this. But this is a completely additional augmentation of the paradigm to give a full understanding of what we're up against, what we're dealing with. And I just honor you so much. Okay, now
go back.
Continue, please, if you could, on
go back to what happened at the Capitol. The whites were violent. And the police?
Were nonviolent, were peaceful.
That's right.
Very much, I mean, uncanny. It was like, I saw a clip just today, as a matter of fact, where it was almost like he was doing a tour. The police officer, when they were in the Capitol, they were saying, look, you know, just try not to sit there and be disrespectful. But it was almost like, and he even said, look, there's five of you and one of me. And so, you know, and he's negotiating as a police officer with the people who broke it. It was, I'm sitting there and I'm like, what the hell just happened? What's going on? But what your framework does, it gives us the understanding of what we're dealing with. This is amazing. So why do you use the term logic? Because it seems to be illogical in terms of the behavior.
No, logic is the discipline.
Okay.
In philosophy. So you have logic, you have metaphysics, you have cosmology, you have axiology, epistemology, and one discipline is the discipline of logic. and their rules for logic and argumentation, all kinds of things like that. Mm-hmm. What I have done is taken the classical training that I had, and I put it into something pragmatic that could explain the behavior that I see around me. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You see, you can't go around saying everybody's crazy. You know, that's, I mean, that might well be, but,
you know. But you need to Bobby, be able to explain.
Bobby Wright was a personal friend of mine. Mm. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And he wrote a book on the psychopathology of white. In essence, white people are psychopaths.
Yes.
And what he did is the same thing that Francis Wellson did.
Yes.
The classical literature of their field and superimposed the behavior on what the definition is. So if this is what they do, this is how you define sociopathic behavior, and this is what white people do, then what is the logical conclusion? They're sociopaths. Well, no, change the rules.
Wow.
That's the same thing with Francis. She took all the psychoanalytic training that she had, literature and what have you, and she put it into the civilization. Mm-hmm. You know, when she talked about the little golf ball in the hole and basketball and all these other kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, symbology of the gun. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Phallus. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So she took classical Freudian psychoanalysis and superimposed the behavior of whites onto it, and they couldn't do anything about it, because if they said it's not right, then their whole field is destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't what she said as much as it was more her. She was pathological.
Mm-hmm.
So they attacked her.
They're right, because you couldn't attack the science because it's right there in front of you.
Exactly.
Wow. Your background, now, if I'm not mistaken, has it been 55 years of this framework, the philosophical aspects of cultural differences?
No, that's been about 40-something years. But I graduated from, this is 2021.
Yeah.
1961. I got my doctorate. That's 60 years ago this year.
Wow, congratulations. What an honor. 60 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm 89.
89. Wow. Yeah. Black don't crack. I mean, really. Wow. No, you know what you look like? You look like, you look like a kung fu instructor. You look like one of those beautiful, like, sages, damn near like Kung Fu Panda. I don't know. You're our Kung Fu Panda. So, now that we have the understanding of the dichotomous logic, if you could now, with this framework, in axiology and how the axiology plays out in what we just saw, but also how the axiology and I guess the epistemology of that, how can we take that and use our person-to-person axiology to our betterment, to our benefit, and to be able to handle this now that we have a framework set in place?
Okay. Let's review. The highest value lies in the object or the acquisition of the object. You want to pull that up?
Okay. You want me to pull up
the paradigm?
Peep there? Hold on a second. What am I sharing here? Okay, Chrome tab. Okay, let's see here. The big dichotomous must be this one. Let's see. Can you see that?
Yeah, that's it. You want to make it so they can see it.
Okay, let's see if I make it bigger. Let's see if it fit. How's that? Or is that too big?
Well, no, they could make it larger for them. You know, I have mine in front of me.
Okay. I didn't cut it. Did I cut anything off? Let me see. Hold on a second. Okay, well. Okay, process was the last piece. Okay, so let's see if it fits. Okay, there we go. All right, fantastic. Okay, go for it, Doc.
Okay. The ethnic groups that comprise the United States are in that far left column. There are people who came from Europe, from Africa, from Asia, and the Native American.
Mm-hmm.
And you have other individuals that share an ethnic worldview. And that is that section you have right there, where it says Africa. Okay, come down a little bit. There you are. Now, you have in that section Latino and you have Arabs.
Mm-hmm.
They share the African world. They share the African worldview with us.
Mm.
Because these are people that are primarily around the equator and a little north and a little south.
Okay.
Now, Hispanics are not an ethnic group. You can be white Hispanic, black Hispanic, Native American Hispanic. You could be Jose Wong or Puchamori and still be Hispanic.
Mm-hmm.
So they are not they are not an ethnic group in and of itself. But what they do is they share an ethnic worldview. See at the top of that column again where it says shared ethnic worldview?
Mm-hmm.
That's what they do. Now, what is necessary to share an ethnic worldview? Three things. Catastrophic event that changed everything for your group of people forever. Mm-hmm. Two, they were forced to speak another language exclusively. And three, forced to convert to a new religion. Mm-hmm. So the forebearers were subjected to colonial Spain, forced to speak Spanish exclusively, forced to convert to Catholicism. Then you identify in this shared ethnic worldview as Hispanic. Mm-hmm. Arabs are much the same way. You have the Islamic wars of conversion. They come all the way across North Africa. They convert to Islam, and they speak Arabic exclusively.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are people who have two of these things, but not the third. So the Kurds have two experiences. The Islamic invasion, convert to Islam, but they don't speak Arabic exclusively.
Mm-hmm.
So they are Kurds. They are different.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, in the European culture, the highest value lies in the object or the acquisition of the object.
Mm-hmm.
And I recently found something that I had read many, many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to share it with you because this is one of the most brilliant people, but not even known about. His name is Thomas Lambo. He was a psychiatrist, a Yoruba. And in a brief conversation with a Dutch correspondent, this Dutch asked him, is there a system that differs considerably between Western practices? Are they broader cultural contrasts between Africa and the West that might be accountable for differences that we see? Mm-hmm. This is what Lambo says. I think so. And they have to do with the orientation toward life.
Mm.
Reality for the African is found in the soul, not in objects.
Mm-hmm.
The aim of life is not to master oneself or the outer things, but to accept a life of harmony with other beings on a spiritual scale. Western philosophy is based on science, and that's one of the, he says, Westerners increasingly believe in the relationship between man and object. African philosophers are based on the explanation of human relationships, which is human person to person. Medicine is a good illustration of the difference. Africans believe that to promote oneself and family from disease, one must live peacefully with one's neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what did he develop as a clinic in Nigeria for schizophrenic patients? They had a village, and your family and the people with whom you have the most contact, like your boss and people like that, all come to the village, and they stay there with you in the village, and you're all kind of working like in group therapy or something like that, and you interact every day together because this person in mental illness is to be out of touch with your relationships. Now, what we do is we say the object is a mental illness. We'll give you the right pills that you can count and measure and correct it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Two TID. Okay? That's counting and measuring the number of tablets you have to take per day.
Mm-hmm.
Or we can act violently against you and give you electroshock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So it's all acting upon you.
This is incredible.
we are working with you to bring you back in harmony with the family. He was extremely successful.
Incredible. Okay, Doc. So when we look at when we look at this logic now, on the logic side, can you give us a differentiation between axiology and the epistemology aspect of it? Axiology is the study of the can you give that to the family?
Yeah, axiology is the study of values. You see, philosophy is the mother science, and it has disciplines. So, you know, metaphysics, cosmology, those are all disciplines of the mother science. And I use three of the disciplines: axiology, the study of values; epistemology asks how do you know, not what you know, but how you know it; and logic, how do you reason to an answer. So those are three disciplines of the class of the mother science philosophy.
Phenomenal.
If I know what is of value to you, then I know how to interact with you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if the highest value is white domination or white being in control, let's do it that way.
Mm-hmm.
All right. They feel that if they're not in control, it can't be done right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So let's look at some of your practical experiences. How many times have you had the white quote unquote supervisor try to tell you to do something and you tell them, no, that won't work?
Mm-hmm.
Or how many times have you gone to him and demonstrated something that you want to do and he said it won't work? Mm-hmm. Because he hasn't authorized it by his method of knowing, which he can't count it and measure it, break it down into little parts and put it together back in the whole and produce it on a line, linear and sequential. Mm-hmm. And you cannot say that has not been successful for them, because if you look at an assembly line in a factory, Ford Motor Company, the highest value is the object. So there was the Model T.
Mm-hmm.
Other countries set with three or four men and built it from the bottom all the way up. They only built one. It would take a group of six or seven men maybe a week to make one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, what he did was to take his epistemology and apply it. So he gave you the number of bolts and screws. He counted them and measured what you were supposed to have. And then he started his assembly line, which is linear and sequential. And so sequentially, when it came to you, you put your bolt or nut or whatever it is on there. You see? Mm-hmm. So parts to the whole,
mm-hmm.
linear sequential, and he counted and measured each object for each part. Mm-hmm. At the end of that, you got an automobile. As it runs along the assembly line, you add your part, you add a fender, you add whatever you add.
Mm-hmm.
That's all you have to add.
Mm-hmm.
Just your part. Because when all those parts come together, it becomes a whole. So their way of knowing, if you look at, under pedagogy for Europeans, you see right there it says parts to the what? To the whole.
To the whole. Mm-hmm.
Now, where do they get that way of thinking? Go down a little further, see Democritus? Or Democritus, however you say it in English.
Where is it?
Right on that. It's right in that same space.
Oh, okay, yeah. Democritus.
Yes. Now.
And Atomus, okay.
He was an Atomist. His idea was there's a void, and there are tiny, tiny, tiny things that he called atoms that come together to make a configuration.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when we finally got the physics advanced enough to know that these little particles were there, what did they call them? Atoms.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. After Democritus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's the way they build their science. Greece is the cradle of Western civilization.
Incredible. This is, I don't know about y'all out there, but I'm in school right now. I'm in university. This is fantastic, Doc. So with the axiology of the African and African American, how can our axiology deal with the interface and the value of the European member to object.
Okay, in this last election.
Can I unshare the screen while you talk and then we can come back to it?
Yeah, if you wish.
Oh, okay, that's okay. Let me see it.
In this last election.
Okay, there we go.
Okay. In Georgia, there was one woman who had run for the governor of the state, lost, mm-hmm. but her zeal was to make sure that these two people got in the city. Now, how did she do that? It was one-on-one.
Yes, it was. One-on-one, door-to-door, a ground game like we've never seen before.
All over Georgia.
Yep. Yep.
And you see, what happens is, if you have a relationship with white people, and that's what they felt that you cared enough about them to come and ask her for their vote.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then for them not to vote would to be treating her with what?
Disrespect.
And that would destroy the relationship.
That's right. Wow. There it is. There's the logic, how you reason to that answer. Phenomenal. Oh, I love you. I just love me some Dr. Nichols. Okay, so how now, did,
how, how did the whites do it?
Okay, please.
Posters, placards, all things that you could what count and measure.
Television ads.
Yes. Yeah. Now, as long as that was the reality in Georgia, black people didn't win.
Mm.
But when this sister gets out there and does the one-on-one, sororities, fraternities went out in their communities and they did the one-on-one.
Do you see this, family? I don't know about you. I don't have hair to blow back, but my facial hair, my beard is blowing back. This is crazy. I never even put that together. That is amazing. So this is why we're the most undefeatable. This is why we're amazing first frequency people. But you got to have a Dr. Nichols to be able to have this level of framework to be able to make it plain so we can apply it to everything, as opposed to he comes on and it just sounds great, but we don't know how to apply it. We don't know how to associate it with our daily lives and seeing it in use in real time. And that, what you just did so.
Oh, goes to South Carolina. Remember, the congressman from South Carolina is the one that put Biden back on the street.
Yes, yes, yes.
How did he do it?
Aha.
Uh-huh. Anytime you look at a picture, you see him in his home, you see Omega Psi Phi.
Mm-hmm.
He's got his little lettering up there. Every time you look, you see. So absolutely. Now, what do you think he has done with his Omega brothers?
What's the question?
What do you think he did with his Omega brothers?
Well, he got with them.
Yes, he did. And he got them to go out and do what they needed to do.
Yes.
Okay.
Wow. And there it is again, person to person, member to member.
That's it, exactly. And that he did with the black community there.
So in a very real sense then, Dr. Nichols, our axiology literally defeated Trump and won this new overwhelming election, if you will, for Biden-Harris, but also what's happening with the Senate. And so it was our axiology that played a part. But hasn't this always been the case? But is there something different about this one versus in the past? Or are there some variables in there?
Okay. Every time, you see, in the elections before, like when this woman was running for the governor of Georgia,
mm-hmm.
they had put restrictions in. One ballot box to deposit mail-in ballots in a county. Now, some of those counties in Georgia, you don't have 20 people in a county.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have the county of Atlantic Atlanta,
mm-hmm.
not even the city, just the whole county,
mm-hmm.
even with the city, how would you get one ballot box? You see, what we have to be careful of is that when the state legislatures pass these things, it will be argued that it is unconstitutional. It will go then to the state Supreme Court. They will say it is constitutional. We will take it to the Supreme Court, where there are now seven that will say it is constitutional. And your brother is leading the group because he's now one of the oldest of the conservatives. You know who I'm talking about?
When you say my brother, our brother.
Yeah, your brother on the Supreme Court.
Not that brother from my mother, from another mother. No, thank you. No, not Clarence Thomas. No, I don't think so. You trying to be slick there, Doc. You tried to slip one in on me. No, that's not my
brother.
Right. You know, what's that term the family uses? All kinfolk, all skin folk ain't my kinfolk or something to that degree. Yeah, that's right. Absolutely. So let's talk about that. You bring up a good point, and that is, what happens when we become so socialized and assimilated, successfully colonized, that do we lose our natural axiological proclivities, or do we morph into that member to object mindset, or is our minds hijacked? What is your take on that? I've never asked you that question before.
Well, you have to remember that in his lifetime, based on his physical appearance, what would he have experienced by other blacks?
Colorism.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yes.
And they would have talked about his big lips and his big nose and nappy hair and all those things.
Yes.
And he grew up with that. And then when he went away to seminary to become a Catholic priest, it was worse. Because you have all these little white boys and the one black one there. It was so bad he left the church, left the priesthood, the seminary for studies, and that's when he went to Holy Cross. Now, he was there on a scholarship, but what did he say about other people with a scholarship? He said there shouldn't be no special rights for affirmative action. There was an affirmative action person there. So now, how does he diss himself from his family? His sister quit her job to take care of his mother and father until they died. And what does he say? He calls her shiftless, lazy, and all these other things rather than give her some money. He calls her almost like a welfare thing. She wants welfare. So what he's trying to do is it's his own personal war. And if you are as black as he sees himself to be, what is the ultimate victory for a black man to have in America?
White identity, white values, white women, so on and so forth.
What does he have for a wife?
This is really a fascinating conversation, because we talked about colorism in one of our
conversations. Let me go a little deeper with this.
Please, absolutely, okay. Sir.
With the woman who said what she said about his calling all these things and calling his penis the Long John Silver or something. If you look like that, what do you have in the black culture that makes you a powerful male? A big penis. So what did he display to her? What did he say to her? I may be all these other things, colorism and so forth and so on, but I got the big bamboo. I can whack you with that, no little sugar cane. Okay,
Doc. I'm just not used to hearing that from you. Okay, go ahead.
I've been black a long time. I keep telling you that. You don't know what's inside here.
You said, don't let that light skin fool no damn body, okay?
Don't be fooled by that. It's serious.
Say amen, okay? Hey, fool it, nobody. You've been black for 89 of these years, okay?
That's right. So now, are you understanding the dynamic?
Yes, sir. It's thank you. It's so clear. So now then, we know we have brothers and sisters out there that are struggling with this identity crisis, of whiteness, values of person, being naturally member to member, but you know, we call them coconuts or Negropeans. Coconuts, brown on the outside, or black, or brown on the outside, and black, or white on the inside. Is there a point, particularly those who came up in Jim Crow, is there a point where these Africans can come back to their original member-to-member axiology, or are they so permanently, I don't know, want to say permanently damaged or socialized, that they're just an example of what not to be in terms of Africa, truly African. What is your thoughts on that? What have you seen in your 89 years?
You see what happens with people like that. They have been so psychologically damaged.
Yeah.
By media that tells you what you're supposed to look like, what is beautiful. That's why with the dolls, remember the doll study, the black doll?
Yes. Yes.
All the children chose the white doll.
Yeah.
And recently the same test was given and they still chose the white doll.
Yep, that's true. About five, six years ago, yes.
Why is that? Because everything that you see on television, for the most part, is white. It's only recently you're getting brown skin people coming in.
Gotcha.
And those sisters are gorgeous.
Yes, yes. Okay.
But that's still not the image that you get when you have the little pickaninny image.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So some children still see themselves as the little pickaninny.
Mm-hmm.
They don't see themselves as the beautiful black girl with the haircut very short and short. They don't see themselves that way. They see the little...
Now, let me ask you this, Doc, and I've never asked you this question as well. And by the way, family, the documents that you just saw, Dichotomous Logic, and the philosophical aspects of cultural difference. There are links above if you're on Facebook where you can download them. And if you're on YouTube, open up the click more or show more, and you can get the downloads that Dr. Nichols just shared with us. What was it like? Now, when you first came on, you went through your academia evolution, how you came to be Dr. Edwin Nichols. But when did you know, I use this piece by Kunjufu about what happens to black boys when they're hit with what I call the three white boys, the white boy on the boat, Columbus, white boy on the stick, Jesus, and the white boy in the sky, which is supposed to be God. And what happens is that the black boys happen to me. We lose our identity all of a sudden, and this is the time when we start acting out, getting labeled with ADD, ADHD, so on and so forth. When you were coming up, when and how did you come into your African consciousness, and where was that intersect? Because you are traditionally trained in the highest levels of European standard. How did you not get lost in the data and the translation of that over time?
Because I went to my daddy's church. He's AME.
Okay. That's enough said right there. That ends that conversation right there. That's okay. So that's why you stay grounded.
Let me explain. My parents were very clear about who we were.
Mm.
Okay? No question. And my father used to read The Crisis. When The Crisis came out on a monthly,
mm-hmm.
he read it cover to cover. He read novels, all kinds of things. He was a literate man. Now, he was a Pullman porter, and his college and all the rest of it didn't count, but, you know, he's like an English major, you know, that was, yeah. that was the day. Now, my mother was, grew up on a farm. And then when she comes to high school, her oldest sister brings her from Illinois to Detroit. Mm-hmm. And she goes to Cass Tech, which is a very prestigious high school there in Detroit for years, Cass Tech. And she did the things that she was supposed to do. Mm-hmm. But in my home, we went to the library twice a week. We walked to the library from where we were living to the main library in Detroit twice a week. Once was to get books, and the other time was to sit and listen to the story hour. Mm. And then once a month, we would go, we shall have read something about a room that we were going to see in the art museum across the street. So if it was about mummies, we read all these little books about mummies and wrapping and all the other things. Mm-hmm. And then we went over to the Egyptian room in the art museum and looked at the mummies and all these things and what have you. So there was a connection. It was a tactile kind of connection between yes. that which you read and that which you actually see.
Yes, yes.
So that was the way, you know. And in my father's church, it was, you know, they sang all the hymns, or they did everything. You know, we had one group that was just as classical in music and the anthems and all this that you could hear anywhere, and the organist played it all. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Then you had another group where they played piano and sang spiritual. Mm-hmm. It was a connection between both. It wasn't either or, it was both and.
It was something and, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Excellent, okay. As we wind down, can you, have you had any new, I think the last few times, the first time that you came on, I don't know if we even talked about it, but I remember the second time, there has been a lot of new research that has come out on epigenetics and genetic memory. Is there any new information that you have that you can share with us that you have used to apply to what you have been teaching for so many years, how that has interfaced with your research and data?
Well, if we are in our regional African state, the highest level is utilization state. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, when you come here with slavery, the trip itself puts trauma into the genes. The conditions of slavery put additional trauma into the genes. Mm-hmm. And then the socialization of the male was destroyed in terms of his family. He couldn't protect his woman from the master sleeping with her and having white children. Mm-hmm. He couldn't stay in a family unit because he could be sold and sent someplace else. Mm-hmm. So it took away from him all of the semblance of family.
And manhood.
And manhood.
Yeah.
Now that's genetically in there as mm-hmm. a part of the trauma that we bring. Mm-hmm. Now we come up to today, and the one thing that needed to be destroyed to destroy the blacks was to destroy the black family, and that was the introduction of drugs. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And to cut down on jobs. So the jobs that black people had from a high school diploma, just like the whites now are feeling it, mm-hmm. so upset, those jobs provided where you have a place to stay and something to eat. Now, redlining, another trauma, I don't care how much money you had, you couldn't move out of that redline district. So that's mm-hmm. why you had a Cadillac parked in front of a tenement house.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember that, yeah. So this is great. This is excellent. So do you see because of what's happening in terms of, one, the birth dearth, where they're not regenerating, repopulating their species, but also because black don't crack, we don't die, we multiply, we're becoming a force to reckon with. Is that, do you think, the reason why we're seeing an uptick in homicides and suicides amongst the European population, particularly on this continent, but it's actually happening around the globe?
Yeah, but we also see it among Blacks. This is the first time that we've seen Black men committing suicide and Black children.
Yes, yes.
So what this whole thing is, what the whole nation is going through, is that we are prepared for the 21st century. See, we're still trying to hold on to manufacturing jobs mm-hmm. that were last century. Mm-hmm. But those jobs are gone. They're never coming back. Mm-hmm. Coal mines aren't coming back. You lie. They're not coming back. Mm-hmm. All across the northern part of Ohio, you know, southern Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, southern Michigan, Illinois, the Rust Belt, that was because U.S. Steel is gone, Bethlehem Steel is gone, all those factories are gone, and they're not coming back. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, the population that's caught in this middle are people who had, they were middle class, but now they don't have. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So either they have to adapt to living as lower class, or they rebel against it. So that's what these guys are fighting for. You look at them and ask, what is the average education of the 100 of them?
High school. High school, if that.
If that.
right. Yeah.
Because they were white and they could get a job in factory. They were the first hired, last fired. We were the last fired, first hired.
Sorry. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now think what that does psychologically to a person that was living middle class, and now they're looking, they're in the food lines to get food.
Yes, yes. Yes. So the assault is not just the birth dearth. The assault is also economic. Yeah. And academic.
Yeah. The reason that it's academic is because if we are a digital society, mm-hmm. an electronic society, so you can't think through those issues and problems to solve without having had algebra. The general math is not going to get you there.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
So you see, that's the fear of loss. That's what they're afraid of.
Wow.
And they're looking to displace their anger to somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the others. Now, the big anger now is on the Hispanics. Mm-hmm. They tried to incorporate the Hispanics to be white. Because mm-hmm. mm-hmm. on that census in 1990, they had an option to be Hispanic, Black, or white. And they opted out. They just put Hispanic. Now you have bilingual signs everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They're saying we are Spanish. We're not white, we're not Black, we are Spanish.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's the largest minority population in the country.
Mm, mm, mm.
And they are working very hard to keep us divided from each other.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because if these two groups come together, it brings the balance of power.
That's it. It's over. This is incredible conversation and incredible education that you've shared with us, Dr. Nichols, because I knew that you would be able to bring us a very, very deeper level and more cogent understanding of what has happened. We've got the big picture of what's going on and the historical aspect of that coming out of the ice. But making it tactical, practical in everyday life, now we are able to see it and have even more language and framework and context. And I just absolutely thank you for that. What's next for you in your research and development? Anything new that we can expect? Anything new that you have come across? Any aha moments that you have come across? You've been doing this so long, or does everything just kind of fit in the jelly jar?
No, I'm a consultant. I still do consulting.
Okay.
So different organizations contact me and they want me to do workshops for them and things like that. And I do. And I make it specific to whatever your group is to try to make sure that you get exactly how it works for your group.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working on something now where people are talking. I try to get people to understand that it's sometimes because we are different in terms of our ethnicity or our essence.
Mm-hmm.
This is different. and we conclude that it's racism. But if we understood the difference between the axiologies, we could understand it. I'll give you a quick example. You have a white male supervisor and a black female clerk. The black white male supervisor walks in and says, the work assignment for today is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and goes out. She says, you come in here yelling and howling and tell me what he wants to do. He didn't even say good morning. Good morning. Hello. Who are you?
People to people, person to person. Is that how we mess up? We keep trying to, we get our axiologies mixed up. Is that what's going on?
You see, that's why I told you that I work white, but I live at home black.
Yes.
See, when I go to work, I'm not equal. I'm object, and I treat them just like objects because I know they're going to treat me that way, and it's nothing personal. So after they mark you down on your performance appraisal and say, let's go to lunch, hell yes, let's go to lunch. And sure. I'll figure out while we're having lunch how I can screw you the next time. It's nothing personal. Don't
right.
Personally. No, no. It's just business. It's just absolutely how we do things.
Wow.
I can't bring that SHIT in my house.
Right, right.
When you're talking and acting white and German and all this other kind of bullshit. No, no. Okay?
Okay. Make it funny, Doc.
Come in here and cook them greens, them ham hocks, them white beans, cornbread. Sit down, eat, and shut up. Okay?
That's right.
Now, of course, if I have friends over and they say, oh, I don't eat pork anymore, I say, oh, I'll get you a kale salad.
Right.
I can do that too.
This is great because there's almost like a, you know, they always say when when in Rome, do what the Romans do. Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene has a great quote where he says, when you are not in your natural environment, sometimes it's natural to act unnatural. If we keep getting hung up and trying to humanize them and treat them as we treat each other, we are going to embed even more trauma inside of us because it's not possible. You're not in your natural environment. You're not in your natural axiological state unless you're with your people. So when you're out or at work or even socializing wherever they may be, you have to become, if you will, bilingual, axiologically bilingual, to understand, oh, I'm dealing with an Amu. I'm dealing with a member to object. Okay, so I have to. So it's like learning a new language in a sense, but it's a behavioral thing. Go ahead. And if we're able to do that, I think we'll be, you know, we can master this. Go ahead, Doc, please.
Go back to the logic system that African Americans use, diunital.
Oh, hold on. Let me share the screen on that. Let's talk about that real quick because I saw that and I meant to ask you what that. Okay, let's see if this is the right document.
All the way to the end.
There we go. Okay, so where is there? It is dilunial diunital.
All right. Now, diunital was a construct that was developed by Vernon Dixon. Okay, and he was talking about what Du Bois had talked about, the double consciousness. And that's what you were talking about earlier in terms of the work environment. So you have to be both and that is, here's member, here's member object, and they're in opposition, but you must bring them to union to work successfully and not go crazy.
Wow, wonderful.
That's diunital.
Wonderful.
Now, you have other groups in there. Remember I told you about the Latins and the Arabs?
Yes.
Do they have the same logic system? Yes. It goes back to the Aztecs and it's called difrasismo. That's the Hispanics. And Ibn Arabi is a famous Arab philosopher, and he calls it the in-between. You have to look at my hands.
Okay? Oh, hold on. Let me.
You can see. They can see that. Can they hear?
No, they can't. They only see the screen.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay, hold on. Let's go back. Okay. Go ahead.
All right. Ibn Arabi says the in-between. So this is your opinion. This is my opinion. It is the in between.
Mm-hmm.
The diurnal.
Mm-hmm.
Afrasismo.
Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it.
So I'm not doing anything that is cognitively dysfunctional.
Mm-hmm.
I work white. I live black. And I bring them together. So that when I have to write a paper or something, I do it this way. Now, what I have over here, I'll put in here. But I know what I'm talking about over here. I can't just give it to them because they can't understand it.
Wow. This is incredible. Now, does that living, does that, see, diurnal to me seems to be a healthier way of, a mentally healthier way of dealing and being in the world, as opposed to, because that's not colonization. That's not domestication. That's not assimilation. That's different. And I think that's healthy. Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what is logical to us.
So it won't harm us, because you know the harm comes in when we get lost in the translation.
Okay. All right. If the high value lies in the relationship, okay? And we're in a relationship. You do something that treats me as less than equal, you treat me with disrespect and destroy the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the highest value is in the relationship, you have an opinion, I have an opinion. In dichotomous logic, you are right and I am wrong. Or mm-hmm. I am right and you are wrong. You can't keep a relationship like that.
No.
So you have an opinion, I have an opinion, and our work is to bring it to union. Now, that's not Hegel dialectic. You know, Hegel gives us thesis, antithesis, synthesis.
Right.
And the synthesis immediately becomes the thesis. It has an opposition and then goes again, and then an opposition and goes again. Mm-hmm. That's dialectic. That's Hegelian. But ours is not Hegelian. Ours is a union of opposites.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they stay unified. It doesn't become a new thesis and antithesis. And
it's kind of the term how we use meet me in the middle.
Yeah.
Which is an African way of being, meet me in the middle.
Yeah, it's a comfortable way of living.
Yes. Wow.
I'm not neurotic, like I go to work and I'm crazy.
Right. That's where I'm going with this. Yes.
Oh, I see.
That's no. I think this is very healthy, because the other way, I think sometimes even when I was translating it, like I got to be almost bipolar in a sense.
Oh, no.
And that's not healthy either, having to go into that, putting that armor on. But with this framework of being diurnal, that is healthy and makes all the sense work, because it flows with logic.
Yeah. When I go to work, I know what I'm going to encounter as member object. Mm-hmm. And so I immediately deal with the reality of member object.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I don't get my feelings hurt.
Mm-hmm.
So if I get on the elevator and this white woman steps all back, that doesn't disturb me.
Mm-hmm.
If I go someplace and they talk about my paper, I was very honored to be a scholar at the Bellagio Study Center, Rockefeller Foundation's Bellagio Study Center in Italy.
Wow.
Very few people get that honor. I stayed for a whole week. Ordinarily, you go for a couple of days, but a whole week. And our team came back. When I got back to the NIMH, there was a white guy who, because I had gone for the week, they were going to try to find some fault with work I had done before I went. Like, you didn't do what you're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
so he called me in and he sat there and he said, I want to go over this paper with you. There are some things that need to be corrected. I said, what are you talking about? He said, there's some grammar. I said, are you talking about Latin grammar in the vocative, which I have difficulty with, but not the other cases? Certainly not German. I wrote my doctoral dissertation in German, and you couldn't You couldn't dare think that I would not know English. What are you talking about? Then I told him, I said, don't you ever talk to me that way. Mm. Because you don't know grammar like I know grammar. Okay.
What shades of pink or purple did he turn?
They put the white boy up there to do it. They put a dumbass white boy up there, didn't know what the hell he was talking about. Okay.
See, I love it when you come on, Doc. See, Doc comes on and he's just real with us. You know, you make it plain, Doc.
If you play it, you get more.
We don't want to see that side of Dr. Nichols. Don't be on the wrong side. Because he's a sweetheart. See, look at that face. Look at that. I was going to say, look at that punum. Look at it.
There's a whole lot of evil.
Cross it the wrong way. All right, Doc, I know you got to go, and I appreciate you.
Well, I'm just simply saying to you that when you're in that environment, you understand how people are going to react to you and treat you.
Yes.
Don't get your feelings hurt.
Yes.
Don't get upset because they don't say anything, or don't get upset because they start criticizing. Just find some way to get back at them in the same style that they use it. Don't bring all that craziness home. Mm-hmm. When you come home, you go through the door. You know, when you, hello, how are you? Family.
Right. Right,
you know,
right.
I don't go to black meetings like I do when I go to white meetings. I go to meetings, I don't say anything. Mm-hmm. If I said something to me, I said, you know, and they want to shake hands or shake hands. That's it. Mm-hmm. You look at the European countries. There's no long greeting because they got to get started on the task right away, or they'll freeze to death and die.
Right, right.
So it's just good morning, or that's it. And in Iceland, they just said, because they're so busy trying to keep from freezing to death.
Wow. Amazing.
You're in long phrases when you greet somebody. Mm. Hello, how are you? How's your family? How's the faith of God? Blessed you. And all the stuff you have to memorize to say. That establishes the relationship.
That is so true. That is so true. Wow. It's such a clean, elegant framework and science. It's just beautiful. Dr. Nichols, we missed your birthday. Didn't you just recently have a birthday?
No, my birthday's in June.
In June?
Yeah.
So last time I talked to you, I think it was around your birthday. I wish you a happy birthday because your daughter bought you this lavish gift. I think it was in Japan. This might have been a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. And so I've been begging to get adopted into the family somehow so that I can get some of these lavish gifts that the family has bestowed upon. But I guess I have to get to my Dr. Nichols level as an elder. So that's going to take some time.
You have to have a daughter whose bucket list is go to all the countries in the world, and she's been to 135.
Wow.
And she's on vacation now, going to another two.
Well, I assume that she's obviously navigating COVID okay and very well. So
yeah, she's got her immunization on. She works in a hospital, so she's a psychologist. And she always brings lovely things back for me that I enjoy, you know. And so lots of times, like, you know, my son gave me this. This is Chinese. I have one picture. I look just like a Muslim because one of the friends of mine, she brought me back. She went to Mecca. Every time she comes back, she has everything. And I don't know how she knows my size. Even though my shoe size, I don't know her that is.
Oh my goodness! And you also was it the opera or a play? It was a play.
Yeah, we went to see, Billie Holiday.
Billie Holiday. Yeah.
That's. I have a picture with her. Everybody wants a picture of it. I was young. 20, just out of the army, I was, 21 when I came out, I was about 22. And we went out to Dearborn, which is as close to Mississippi, Alabama, and Georgia. It abutresses Detroit. Mm. And the mayor at that time said, "If as long as I remain the mayor of Dearborn, no niggers will live in Dearborn." Mm. And he lived, and there were none there. And now it's all, and it's completely an Arab city.
Wow. Just
Detroit. But at that time, to go out to this white nightclub to see her, but she said, whenever I'm in the north, anybody that wants to be black could come and see me. But you know, the South is segregated. Well, this was as segregated as you could get. Of course, when you go there, do you have a membership? Do you have all this stuff? Mm-hmm. And we were standing there, there were four of us, and she walked by and she said, "Oh, hello, baby, how are you?" All this, you know, and we said, "What's going on?" I said with my big mouth, "They don't want to let us in." Then she said, "You know how she curses?"
Yes.
"My ass, I'm gonna get the hell out of this." You know, so the guy said, "Oh, there's some mistake." She said, "Damn, why is a mistake?" She said, "Oh, gentlemen, come right on in. We didn't have to pay the fee and what have you."
Wow.
And after each set, she would come down and sit at our table. Now, we were all 22. You know, we were just full of, you know, what, you know, and vinegar.
Yeah.
And she sat at our table and had drinks. Wow. And I have a all nestled up to her, like, you know.
There's a movie that's coming out on her that I can't wait to see. That is this beautiful soul.
You know,
did you see Ma Rainey? I know we're supposed to have these kind of conversations off air. Did you see Ma Rainey?
Yes, I've seen it many times. The play. I haven't seen the movie.
Oh, okay. You haven't seen the Netflix version of it yet.
No.
So you saw the play. Okay.
I've seen the play several times.
Okay. Well, let me know, because I just thought, you know, Viola Davis, Chadwick Boseman, Glenn Turman. I mean, it was a magical moment of captured history. It was absolutely incredible.
Yeah. He's all that. Yeah.
Absolutely. All right, my good friend. I love you. Family, please like, subscribe, share. Again, the links to the Dichotomous Logic and the framework for the philosophical aspects of cultural differences is at the top if you're on Facebook, and if you're on YouTube, it's at the bottom. Now, when you print that out, you'll have something to follow, and you can start incorporating this framework into your life and understand from an axiological framework and understanding exactly what's going on. Nobody can do it better than you, Doc. I'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hotep King, Hotep Community. Uncle Job Sinep.